DCM works. Wear us like a hat.
So this week I want to thank patrons. Shit, I just had the list in front of me. This is...
Wow.
This is a shaky start. Derek Derrickson, who has been with us for a while, and he actually just increased the amount he's donating, so big shout out to Derek. Jackie from Adelaide, that's her screen name. I don't know that she's from Adelaide.
That's pretty cool.
And Carla. So shout outs to you guys for being a Patreon. Thanks for supporting us. And I really like that sweater on you. Hey guys, big welcome back to another episode of the Art for Artists podcast, the sweatiest podcast on the internet. It's a hot day in Australia. Yeah. I'm David DCM, creative director, lead writer at DCM Works. This is my co-host Ben, as always. I'm
sweaty McGee over here.
It's a warm day in Australia because it's fucking summer, mate.
Summertime.
This is a summer podcast series. Mm. It's not. It's just... We have summer cricket series, right?
We have summer everything series.
Yeah, probably. Except
cancer
except
series.
Probably like not soccer because it's too hot to play soccer in the heat.
Soccer's a winter sport.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Yeah. But is it a winter sport in England? Does that mean it's a summer sport here? You know what I'm saying?
I don't know. Maybe a summer sport there because it's too cold otherwise.
Podcast at dcm.works if you know the answer. Don't email me about that shit.
This is Christopher Walken here to warn you that this contains some explicitly foul language, and if you don't like that, then I'll put my foot in your throat.
The soundtrack's amazing.
Yeah,
the visuals are very like well done, and like the gameplay is super fun, and like because those three things are there, it's like it's exceptionally good.
Hey, I could do it in a heartbeat and make millions, but it would feel like gouging my soul out.
Yeah, Jurassic Park's a little more like DDR.
If Shrek is a fairy tale creature, can he actually own land and want to kick them off?
Where did that come from?
You have to make a lot of shit up to make good art.
Yeah.
That's just the truth, buddy.
Or do whatever. I don't mind.
We love the attention.
We tolerate the attention. All right. So this week we're talking about our best and worst of the year.
Top 10
mostly
list.
Best. But before we do that, what time is it, Ben?
Oh, it's time for us to say what we're doing.
What are we listening to?
Yeah, that one.
Theme song. Don't make a theme song every time. We have one pre-recorded, but you can do that if you want.
All right.
I will cut. I'll keep yours in as well. They'll be Thank both. You. All right. So, what have you got for what are we listening to this week, Ben?
I watched all of One Punch Man, or at least all that was available.
Yeah, all the 10 episodes that are up at this
the
point.
The first 10.
Bearing in mind that it's the start of December, if you're not watching this.
Yeah, because of recommendations from apparently numerous people. I wanted to watch it because it looked hilarious.
Yeah,
and it is hilarious. It's
yeah.
good.
It's good. If you want to hear
got really
more...
good animation.
Yeah.
Apparently it's like, so it's done by Madman Studios.
Yeah.
But it's like, it's basically like the animation team behind it is basically the Avengers of Japanese animation.
Oh,
it's
okay.
Like all this crazy talent from like Gundam, like
I know it's the guy who Evangelion. From I know one of the guys from Bones Studio who worked on Darker Than Black and did all the fight
yeah,
scene
there's
choreographies
like,
on
oh there. Yeah, like each fight scene is done by a different animator.
Yes.
So you can watch a fight scene and see the different
super interesting, yeah.
Yeah, like see the different styles of animation in each one.
Yeah.
Like some of them will just be like sort of like even there's even some like Attack on Titan stuff in there. The animator for the Titan fight scene in AOT did some fight scenes in One Punch Man.
Hmm. Okay.
Yeah, it's really good. Yeah. The storyline's just fucking stupid. Like, the idea of him taking anything out in One Punch,
that's amazing.
They use it really well.
There's a fantastic line in that where they're like, oh, so what kind of... Because he goes away and he does, like, training and becomes a superhero. Like,
yeah.
Oh, what kind of... What's your training regimen?
It's completely
regiment?
Inexplicable.
They're like, what's your training regimen? He's like, oh, I run 10Ks and yeah, I do, like, 50 push-ups.
But it builds it up so... There's, like, three of them and it builds up for, like, a solid 3 minutes. Where it's like, no! They'll know because he didn't... Like, they don't really know, like, the reason why he's so strong. Even he doesn't. Well, he kind of does. He puts it down to training when it's not.
When he just trains like a normal person.
Yeah, it's like...
He's just a little bit fitter
like,
than
yeah,
normal.
It's like 10-kilometer run, 100 sit-ups, 100 push-ups.
That's it.
100 squats and that every day. And it's like...
He's just quite what? Fit.
and like him before he loses his hair and him after, like not only does
he's
like he
loses his hair,
he just completely changes, like his whole facial features are completely different.
It's become super bizarre to look
yeah
at.
It's so ridiculous, and it's like they're not the same person. It's just
it's
but
great.
It's so tongue-in-cheek.
Yeah, it's very if you like Black Books or like any of that kind of really humor that knows it's over the top, yeah, but doesn't overdo it, it's great.
And like it's ridiculous because he's like the strongest, easily the strongest in the world, yet when he like signs up to be a hero, spoiler alert, he gets put at literally the bottom of the ranking.
Yeah,
because he just fucks up the writing test.
Yeah, because
he gets full marks on the physical exam. In fact, he beats every record they had, but he gets a C because he failed because he's an idiot.
But like I think the best part is that one of my favorite things about that show is at the end of every episode, whoever the villain who he's defeated will introduce the next episode.
Oh yeah,
which is just a really nice touch.
Yes,
but it's because they never have visuals by the time they've done that episode, so they'll just describe to you what the next episode is gonna be.
Yeah,
in like their villain voice, and that's
and
the end
like,
of the episode.
Oh my god!
And you're like, okay, I guess that was 30 seconds of that.
Pretty much every episode, except for a few of them, are just like one parters.
Yes,
like a few two parters, which are like infuriating because I'm currently on halfway through one of them.
Yeah,
episode 10 ends on the cliffhanger. It's like, but it's like they're like 20-minute episodes. And there's always some like earth-shattering apocalypse incoming,
pretty much.
And like there'll be like all this character development of everyone like being super worried, and then he just comes in and
punches a guy,
and it just dies or whatever.
It's the solution.
And it's ridiculous.
It's genius. He's a Deus Ex, and it works fantastic.
Oh yeah, it's exactly what it is. But they do it well. They make him surprisingly human as well, because he like. He hates the fact that he kills people in one punch.
Because he wants
a real fight.
There's a great scene where he has a dream that he's in a real fight, and he like wakes up like he's like sweating and
yeah,
shit. Yeah,
he's like, oh, it's just
like, oh my god.
And then he goes outside, and the guys he was fighting in the dream are actually there, but they're like a quarter of the size.
Yeah.
And he just like steps on one of them.
He
steps on their leader, and the leader dies, and then they surrender and run away. And he's like, oh.
Good. That's a good. What we've anything else you've been listening to?
I re-downloaded an album from MC Frontalot, which is this guy who does quote-unquote nerdcore, which is it's this weird genre of rap where it's just the lyrics are just
it's
really nerdy and like me. It's kind
dumb.
Of bad.
It's dumb. I hate it.
I don't really like it.
It's like the worst version of Damble.
Yeah, and it's...
Go listen to Damble instead.
It's all right, better. And some of his songs are really shit,
yeah.
But I've been listening to it, I guess.
No, the problem is it's not ironic enough.
Yeah, no, some of it's like
it takes
way
itself
too
serious.
Yeah, like there's one about porn being weird, and it's just
it's like shut up.
It's just like
you don't know.
All right,
you don't know what you're doing.
Yeah,
no, that's a good.
That's it.
Any TV or anything?
Week.
That's it. No TVs and movies.
I started watching Bones.
Oh, that's funny. I guess.
Yeah.
Don't.
It's all right.
Not worth it.
I mean,
not
I'm
worth
like,
it. Not worth it.
I've been watching it with my girlfriend.
Takes like 5 seasons, and then they finally get together.
Yeah,
she's
like, oh, it's so good. I'm like,
and
yeah,
all the drama
all right.
of the show is gone when they get together, because they're together, and then they have a baby, and that's not even interesting. It's a fucking boring show after
oh,
all.
Oh, yeah, if they get together, that would
Don't stop
it.
After season four.
I'm like 4 episodes in, so
okay.
I'll...
Stop after season four.
Okay.
Or don't, whatever.
I'll just
Your
watch,
choice.
I'll just watch season one, that's all I need to watch.
Watch Mad Men instead.
Okay.
That's on Netflix, you don't have Netflix.
I do want to watch, at some point, I need to watch, what's that show with Kevin Spacey.
The House of Cards.
Yeah.
Don't, it's bad. I hate it. I'm sorry. It shits me.
Never mind.
Yeah. No, you can if you want. I'm not going to tell you what to do. I had a specific thing I was going to remember to talk about that I've forgotten. But
right.
I've been listening to... I just started rewatching Black Books, which is why I mentioned it before. Very funny. It's like a comedy made in like 2002, and it's maybe the best. It's about a drunk bookshop owner who just drinks all the time and is a cunt.
Sounds about
and that's
right.
the show.
Yeah.
It's great. What else have I been listening to? Oh, yeah. Blue October just dropped a live album that's like a preview of the album that's coming out next year. And it's really good if you're into... They've been around for years, so if you know who Blue October is, which you don't. I'm talking to the people.
I don't.
The people.
I don't.
If you're in America, you've probably heard of them. They're kind of an institution over there in Texas. They're really good.
They're a big deal.
Yeah, they make... Well, they're kind of not a big deal, but they've just been there forever.
Yeah.
And they're fantastic. And they've got a new album coming out, and the live version is out on Spotify, and it's so good. Logic just released a new album, which is pretty good as well.
Yeah.
I haven't really been watching any TV this week. I've been pretty busy, aside from Black Books. I just watched a few episodes of that. And if you're not in Australia, you won't know what this is, but Hack, which is a program on Triple J...
Yeah.
They did a special on like the Australian porn industry, and it's super interesting.
Really?
Yeah, it was really interesting. Huh. So Tom Tilly.
I didn't know Australia had a porn industry.
Yeah, exactly. So he goes. No, yeah, that was exactly the point.
Yeah,
he goes.
Kind
of
weird.
He gets this panel of like people that watch porn, people that make porn, and people that are like anti-porn, and he kind of goes and does this bunch of this research.
Oh
and
yeah.
There's this great.
Hack's really good.
Yeah, there's this great interaction, and it was on ABC too, so you can watch. It's like an hour and a half special. Or whatever. Yeah. And there's a particular...
Oh, yeah, I saw the ad for that.
Yeah, and he goes to a porn set, and he talks to the people working there, and they're just, like, super normal people, and then he talks to the producers, and they're the most weird people in the world.
Oh.
And it's just super, like... It's like, oh, my God, this is, like,
the craziest shit. I feel like that's a case where, like, the people who work in porn are just, like, normal people trying to make money, but it's the producers are the weird ones.
Yeah, super interesting if you want to get a little more educated.
On the porn.
On the porn. Well, it's kind of interesting as well, because there are people that have, like, these really extreme opinions about it from either side, and they're both wrong.
Yeah.
Like, so it's just a good lesson in like, don't ever think you're totally correct, because that's often.
I've known a lot of really anti-porn people.
Yeah, they're usually wrong.
They get very aggressive at like anything that's even remotely.
Which is weird, because like it's kind of like being anti-religion. Coming. You have to have at least consumed enough religion to know that you don't want it.
Yeah.
Anyway. That's what I listened
to.
Way of putting it. Yeah, I don't think I've got anything else new. I just started the Witcher 3 DLC finally.
No.
I bought it like when it first came out 2 months ago, but I still hadn't finished the game because it's obscenely long.
Yeah, it's like one of the biggest RPGs.
I love it and I hate it. I'll talk about that later. But yeah, that's gonna be what I've been listening to. So this week on the show we are talking things of the year.
Things of the quote-unquote year.
No, okay, well, I'll explain a few ground rules before we get into it. This is stuff that Ben and I have consumed this year. Not necessarily
understand.
Stuff that came out this year.
I consume things at an alarmingly slow rate.
Well, that's because you are, like,
I am
a few years behind.
Like, you know that there's an XKCD comic about a joke that, like, the guy who plays games 5 years later, that's actually me.
And Ben walks in, he's like, oh my god, I just finished Tomb Raider.
Yeah, I'll literally be like, dude, Witcher 1 is really bad.
Yeah,
and it's like,
it's pretty,
yeah,
that happens a lot.
Congrats.
You will periodically send me something and you're like, hey, I just finished playing blah blah blah. What a piece of garbage. And I'm like, yeah, Ben, it's not 2004.
No. Like, I literally have all of the Mass Effects. I haven't played them yet. And I'll probably play them next year sometime.
In fairness, nor have I.
And then be like, I really like Mass Effect now, even though it's 5 years late.
Or you might. There's a new one coming out, apparently.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
well,
I don't know.
I guess. Anyway.
Mass Effect Andromeda or whatever.
So, like, for me at least, I tried to keep this mostly this year, but there are a few things which...
I did not try.
All right.
They,
at least
I think,
I'm off the hook in terms of that.
I think they all are except for three. No, that's a lot.
Only two of mine
Actually, I was looking at my other list. Most of them are not this year. No, most of them are.
Only, like, two of mine aren't this
year. My movie was from this year.
I think we probably have the same movie.
Oh, this is going to be embarrassing. But yeah, so a few ground rules. It's stuff that Ben and I subjectively enjoyed the most. I think something important to realize is that
this
we're not saying this is objectively the best thing of the year for a given category.
This is what we loved.
What we're saying is what we loved, and whether or not that's contextual because it got us at the right time or whatever, we enjoyed it, and we'll talk about a little bit about why we enjoyed it and then move on to the next one.
Yeah.
So I'll lay
There's a lot of categories.
Yeah, so I'm going to lay out the categories. We're going to try and limit them a little bit, and then we'll do some honorable mentions at the end of other stuff.
Yeah, that's fair.
Just because I've a mental list of things I want to mention that I enjoyed that didn't quite make my list, but I think
I got honorable mentions like within.
Yeah. Like, oh yeah. List. So I've got a few things that I crossed out that I'm going to mention as we go.
Yeah.
That were like my toss ups.
Categories.
So I'll run through the categories really quick. So we have game of the year, movie of the year, TV show of the year, YouTube video / series of the year, because I felt like that was an easier way to categorize
YouTube,
that.
Just serialized YouTube.
Yeah, or it could just be like a one-off or whatever, but I wanted to include series as well. Music album of the year, and that can be a single or an LP as well. Print media, so anything that's like a novel, a comic book, whatever, any kind of
and
print.
And I cheated by putting an ebook in
which
there,
is fine, because that counts.
Just
anything that isn't other like media.
Yeah.
And then a podcast of the year.
Which obviously went to this.
No, it didn't. It went to other stuff that's better. So, we'll start with Game of the Year, because that's obviously what we always talk about. I want to get it out of the way first.
Yeah.
So, what was your Game of the Year?
So, the real one is Hotline Miami 2. The one that's cheating, because it came out December last year, is Talos Principle. And I wish Talos Principle
what
came
out. What is Talos Principle?
Talos.
Talos.
T-L-O-S.
Good choice.
So, it's made by Crow Team. So, they're the guys who did Serious Sam.
Yes.
They're out of Croatia.
Which Ben is a massive fan
fucking
of.
So, Serious Sam was like... is what my Duke Nukem was.
Yeah,
and he essentially is Duke Nukem.
I know. Oh, I know, Ben.
And
the people probably have known that you're a big fan.
So
I think you can miss it.
this team of Croatia, and, like, they have, like, the... they're like, in terms of being PC developers, they're basically the new id Tech. in terms of they have an amazing engine.
Yeah.
Like, they're really heavily PC focused.
He means id Tech before Doom. No, it not
Tech before
Doom.
Rage.
Before Rage. That's what I meant.
Like,
in my head, I had Rage. I meant Rage.
Like, id Tech 3 before.
Yes, yeah.
Not id Tech, whatever they use now.
Well, Doom 4 was pretty good. Sorry, continue.
No, it wasn't.
So, well, for them, it was.
Serious Sam is, like, just this ridiculous, over-the-top shooter. And then they're like, yeah, like, for our new engine, the Serious Engine 4, which is amazing, they're like, yeah, we're making a philosophical puzzle game about the ethics of training AI to take out tasks, and also there's an apocalypse, and also we'll talk about the Bible a lot.
Actually,
so,
the Bible does come up a lot.
I mean, it's called the Talos Principle.
Yeah, but like, I mean, like, I just, on it does, yeah,
so,
I've not thought about
Talos,
it.
Talos, like, Hotline Miami 2, everyone knows what that is, but Talos Principle,
you've talked
I
about
feel
that
like,
before.
I feel like deserves, like, a lot of mention because it just came out, like, December 11th last year.
Yeah.
Like, on PC.
Yeah.
And it's probably one of the best puzzle games I've ever played. It's pretty similar to, Portal, but less humor, more philosophy.
Yes, but it
still has the same really good writing. It's still got the same, like, disembodied voice.
I think it understands its conceit very well. So, like, it never feels, like, it never feels pretentious at any point because it knows,
yeah,
it knows that it's being, like, it understands.
It knows what it is.
Yeah.
And it presents its narrative really well. It's also super fucking meta. There's like terminals throughout the game that you read most of the lore through.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you just go up to a terminal and you just read like email clippings and like newspaper clippings and stuff like that.
Kind
and
of
just
the same
information.
As like a 4x4, like a terminal.
Yeah.
Or like a holotape or something.
And probably the funniest example was a lot of the time they'll hide text behind like a hex code. You have to decode through something else, which is like, oh, that's cool. It's like a puzzle.
It's groovy.
And one of them was like, it was this email from like a professor. So all the emails you assume come from the real world, and you're in like the simulation world, essentially.
Yep.
So you're reading this email, and it's about like, it's like, oh, you know, your professor here, I want you to write a 1500 word essay on like what you believe the difference. It's like, the question was like, what do you believe the difference between like humans and robotics? And like, where does the line get blurred? And I'm like, oh, that's kind of cool. And then it was like, send your like submissions to, and then a bunch of hex. And I'm like, oh, I want, because this whole time I'd been decoding the hex in it to see what it says. I'm like, oh, I wonder what this hex says. So I decode it, and it says facebook.com/crowteam.
Nice.
And I'm like, oh my god, they want us to literally write 15. So I did.
Of course you did.
I did.
What
I wrote
else
a,
you doing?
I wrote a 1500 word philosophical essay.
Philosophical?
Philosophical.
I wrote a
essay
philosophical essay. I wrote a falafel.
The difference between robots and humans, and sent it to their Facebook team.
Yeah.
And I didn't receive anything. But, I mean, it was cool.
It's done now.
I mean, I think they collated them.
What a nerd.
Collected them, and yes. But, like, that sort of attention to detail is,
yes,
like, really cool. Like, there was literally even, like, it was, like, submissions are due. And it was, like, January 12th. And, like no year. It was just January 12th. But the game came out December 11th.
Mm.
So it was like, oh, this is actually a thing. They actually
I've got
us
homework.
Yeah. So
you made that sound very unexciting, but it's a great game.
Oh yeah, like the game itself is really good. It's like really well made puzzles. Some of the later levels get like insane.
Mm.
Like if you think of Portal being like, you know, like especially Portal 1 being like a 2-hour tutorial for like the last half hour essentially.
Mm.
The Talos Principle is like a 5-hour tutorial for the last 2 hours.
Yeah.
And the last 2 hours were insane. Like, in terms of the storyline that it just plows on you and everything. And there's an expansion, which I haven't played. I don't have any money, but
I'm
I really
poor
want to play it.
Because I'm poor.
It's just more of the same. But, like, the, you know, good game. Like, the game's beautiful visually.
Yes.
And they throw in a lot of, like, sort of purposeful glitches.
Yeah.
Like, within the world. Like, textures will just, like, disappear for a second.
It's very, it's, yeah.
There's literally, like,
gets in your head.
Yeah, like there's part, there's like so many Easter eggs in it, like based around Serious Sam as well, which is like, yes,
so it just,
love
it. Just pushes old Ben's buttons.
Yeah,
so get amongst it, like it's a good time.
Yeah, it's really cheap.
Yeah,
because
there,
Pro Team makes their games really cheap.
What was your other honorable mention for that? Hotline Miami 2.
Well, that was the real one.
Oh, that was the real one.
Because that came out this year.
And you've talked about that before.
Yeah,
it's a good game.
It's
stupid
great,
fun.
Yeah, great soundtrack.
My game of the year. So originally, I'd written Witcher 3 DLC. No, specifically the DLC.
Specifically the DLC.
Because it's tight. It's well. It's like 20 hours, but it's tight. It's well written. The first one I'm talking about, not Blood and Wine. I'm talking about Hearts of Stone.
Yeah.
It's tight, it's well constructed, it buys into the conceit super well. It's basically a heist film, but in the Witcher world, and incredibly well.
Yeah.
And they introduce this new system. They introduce some new characters that are fantastic. You meet this immortal guy. And like one
he's
of the immortal.
First
it's cool. Not a spoiler because it's in the trailer, but like in the first 5 minutes of when you're actually playing, not just the opening cutscene, you cut his head clean off and he just walks over and picks it up and puts it back on. And it was just like...
That's brutal.
Which has never happened in that world before.
Yeah.
So it was like, oh, whoa. Okay. And then the rest of it's this amazing heist thing where you gather together a crew. You kind of cobble together a crew and you take on this heist thing. Fantastic. And I was going to make that my game of the year, just the DLC. But then I was like, but I also... It still has all the problems I had with the original Witcher, which is that the combat becomes too easy when you get good at it. Nothing really scales properly, so you can go from like fighting an enemy that's too easy to one that you literally can't kill.
Yeah.
Like, it's still got the same problems the Witcher does, as much as I love that game. So it's gonna have to go to AC Syndicate just for dumb fun.
Oh, you
like my
you
KFC
chill.
That's my KFC bucket of chicken. Like, it's just stupid fun. So instead of that being my game of the year, because I don't want to make KFC my game of the year, it's gonna be Among the Sleep. Which I only played for Halloween.
That's
this
that
year.
That's that spoopy game.
When you're a baby.
Oh, yeah, fuck
I played
that
it
shit.
On my channel for Halloween, and it was the scariest. I screamed.
Yeah, I think, like, last year when they announced that, I read, like, what the game was, and I'm like, no, I'm never playing that. That sounds horrible.
It was just, it was the most intense, like, 2 hours. It's not a long game, but it's just so well made. So that gets my game of the year for this year. Probably next year it's going to be Fallout 4, because I haven't really got far enough into that yet. I played like 60 hours, but I'm still not far enough
I don't know
what
my game next year will be, because it hasn't come out yet, probably.
Probably has. Probably came out 3 years ago.
Yeah, good point.
So that's our games. We won't linger too much. Our movie is...
Mad Max Fury Road.
Mad Max Fury Road. Mad Max Fury Road.
Mad Max Fury Road.
It's a good film. Tom Hardy's amazing. Everyone in that film acts amazingly. It's great setting. It's great action. It's a great film. Get the fuck amongst it.
It's
so good.
It's the second best.
Need we say more? Probably not. Don't.
Well, Mad Max 2 is
film of the year.
Oh, do you know
what?
Fury Road is basically Mad Max 2.
It's the best film. It's not the best Mad Max film.
Well, I mean, the first Mad Max film isn't really
the kind of
same as the others.
It's. I would argue that it's the best Mad Max film. That's like totally.
I mean, there's probably gonna be two more like new age Mad Max films. Oh yeah, definitely.
It's so good. But yeah, definitely our film of the year.
Yeah, well, easily. Like, I was like, when I was researching this, I was like, movie. So I typed in, I forgot what movies I'd seen this year. So I typed in, I was like, top movies 2015.
Yeah.
And then the first one was just Mad Max. I'm like, oh yeah, it's Mad Max. Yeah,
it is,
of course.
Yeah.
Like, what else? I was like, is it Spectre? Like,
Spectre
I saw that
right.
recently. Yeah, but it's not Mad Max.
No. So it was going to be, mine was, the only thing that was coming remotely close was,
I was going to say Interstellar, but that was last year.
Yeah,
that was like November.
I was thinking something that I watched this year because I don't really go to cinemas. I don't really have the time. It's gone from my head. I watched that in November. No, but yeah, definitely Mad Max without the question.
Yeah.
Easy. So TV show, what did you have?
BoJack Horseman.
Oh, that's such a good choice. Why did I pick BoJack? Oh, it's such a good show.
So season 2 came out this year.
Look, I think it might be the best TV show ever made. Maybe.
Oh. Best cartoon
I think
ever made
probably
so
yeah
far. Like in like, terms of like if you look at like adult cartoons like South Park
you
want to
be sad
like
about
that.
Life
oh yeah like it's easily
and also laugh at a horse instead of realize like it's just
yeah
everything
it's a roller coaster of emotions.
I've talked about this before in separate things like I've mentioned a show on my channel before but like
it's so good
it's like if you have any interest at all in
anything
comedy but you're
drama.
Like but you hate shit that's dumb
and
you watch it
your life is a husk
if you it. Ever want to feel empty like there are moments in that show where there will be something that is so unbelievably heartbreaking then they'll cut to credits and then like every other show would cut to credits and then like the start of the next episode will be happy. BoJack
no,
it's sadder
credits,
than it ever was
and then
like,
stays sad
there's a moment
but I think the good thing about BoJack is that it redeems itself in the end of every well except maybe the first season. The first season ends pretty rough. The second season just gets rougher but then ends really well.
I think the show redeems itself but he never does.
Oh him as a character doesn't but like as a viewer you go away feeling better
yes
at the end of it. There's... like halfway through you feel like shit you're like why am I watching
yes.
this shit
yes
but then by the
but
end
you watch it the thing is you watch it to wait for it to get better knowing that it won't
but then it does, but, and it does slightly.
It doesn't get better. It gets resolved to a degree, and you're like okay, that's about as much closure as I get in real life, so I feel okay about it.
And it does a really good job of sort of bringing sort of people to the same mindset, because you can be like super fucking depressed.
Yeah.
You'll watch the show and you'll stay super fucking depressed.
Yeah.
But you can be fairly, like, you know, fine with your life, watch the show, and it'll make you super fucking depressed. So for the period of, like, you know, in season two at least, like episode 5 onwards,
everyone's
at the same mindset of, oh, Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
But they kind of bring everyone kind of comes up to the same level at the end.
Yeah,
so
it's like
no matter what, it has a beneficial impact.
Yeah, they bring you as a viewer.
Like, it has a net gain as a show.
I think as an experience to go through and sit through, you come out of it and I guarantee you'll learn something.
Oh, yeah.
And there's this beautiful, toward, like, the very last episode, there's this beautiful moment where you think everything's kind of resolved, and you have this moment where the show ends, but it kind of, they play this song by Courtney Barnett, and it starts off where it's sort of this, and I think it's the most beautiful song they could have picked for the end of the season, and it's where, Courtney Barnett, she's sort of talking about, as much as, take her or leave her, right? I love her, but some people hate the shit out of her.
Yeah.
So don't be sending me letters. seriously, people, like, attacked the shit out of her for winning Triple J's Album of the Year.
She was,
or whatever it was, the J Award. But yeah, so there's this beautiful song she has where it's sort of about her waking up and, like, in her apartment, and it's, like, grossly hot because it's Australia. And she's like, I might go do some gardening today. Maybe. And so she goes outside and she has an asthma attack and ends up in a hospital. And it's all about how, like, irritatingly weird that is for a day. She's just like irritated that she didn't, that like she missed her midday cartoons or whatever,
because
she's at hospital, and she's annoyed that her neighbor's gonna ask her why she went to hospital the next day. Like, it's just a super song. It's a song that is so perfectly in touch with the tone of the show that it ends the season and you have this crippling sense of things might get better. And I think that's the worst thing, is that show gives you hope every time.
Oh, yeah, that's the problem, because season three and 4 have been confirmed.
Yes.
So season 3 is coming out probably, like, again, July next year,
because
that's when they usually come out, around July.
Yeah.
So that'll be a...
But yeah,
and the thing with BoJack is that they come out all at once, because it's a Netflix show. Also because it's Netflix, it's not written for advertisements.
Yes.
So it's very consistent.
So it's impossible to watch all of them at once, because you will just... become
just
a mess.
You'll,
like,
just plow through
it's kind of,
it's easy to get through, but it's also fucking difficult
it's
to get
kind
through.
Of like my TV show of the year.
Segway. All right,
no, it was Daredevil.
I haven't watched any Daredevil. Watched a bit of Flash,
probably. Daredevil. Sorry, the Flash is fine. Daredevil, just the best show that I've seen in a long time. I think it was gonna be Jessica Jones, to be honest. But the more I was thinking about it, the more I was like, I've watched Daredevil twice, which I never do. I can't watch things twice, but I watched it twice because I enjoyed it so much.
Yeah.
And as much as there's some hammy acting toward the end from one fucking character who does a great job until his final climax where he goofs, it's just the best show. And I walked out of it and I was like, that was sensational. So yeah, it's Daredevil, but by a hair beating Jessica Jones, and then that by a hair beating Friday Night Lights. And Friday Night Lights is a show about... a small Texas town, and it's about football, and it's about a coach.
Football.
I don't even like football. I didn't know the rules of American football before I watched the show.
I mean, right? I watched The League, which is a show about fantasy football.
No, this is not that.
It's hilarious.
This is a drama about a high school football coach and his life and his family, and it is the single... I've never cried so much at a TV show before.
Well, the good thing about shows like that is that you're able, like, the sort of setting is just a vessel... That's like most drama is just like the setting's just the vessel for the drama.
Yeah. And the writing is just, it's...
Yeah, it's like, all about the characters.
It's just, it's the most amazingly constructed TV show. And it only lost to Jessica Jones and Daredevil because...
It's not Jessica Jones or Daredevil.
No, it had a really weak season 4 where they had the lead writer went away to do something else and he came back in season 5.
And he's just like, what the did you do
with
this?
He was like, what happened? But yeah, so it's Daredevil followed closely by Jessica Jones. I know that's not how it works. I have to pick an outright winner, but it is Daredevil.
Oh, yeah, that's fair.
Okay, YouTube series video of the year that you enjoyed.
This is one of two, and it's probably the best current video games journalism in video form that exists.
Yes.
And it's between...
Oh, boy.
I'm going to go with one, because the other one will get a mention later. Yeah. It's between Super Bunny Hop and...
Oh, wait, can you say video games journalism again?
Video games.
Yeah. There we go.
Well, games journalism.
And there we go. Done.
It's
there you go. You're welcome. Don't send me emails. I did it.
It's either Jimquisition,
mm-hmm.
fucking Jim Sterling's son, or
yep,
Super Bunny Hop. I'm gonna give it to Jimquisition just because, especially this year, like the stuff he's done is just like insane.
Yeah,
like he's pretty much single-handedly covered like stories that most other journalists have kind of shied away from,
mm-hmm.
and he basically has no base, like, I guess, no contractual obligation to not be an asshole. So yes. Pretty much everything he says is straight him. Because he used to be part of The Escapist.
Yes.
And about a year and a half ago, he went just solo.
And I've talked about how much I dislike The Escapist before. So yeah, they're really bad. We don't have to get into this.
So he went solo, and it's pretty much the best things he's ever done, because he's able to pretty much just speak his mind on most issues.
Yeah.
Which
is both good and bad, but it's largely been beneficial.
So probably his biggest contribution this year has definitely been the Konami issues.
Yes.
He's pretty much single-handedly been the driving force in hashtag fuck Konami.
Yeah.
Because Konami is the worst. And I guess Super Bunny Hop has also done some things in Konami.
Yeah.
Probably most notably, George Wieman, the guy who does Super Bunny Hop, he got in contact with an anonymous source inside Konami who he was able to confirm was like, yeah, it's legit, I just can't say who he is. And basically did a story on what was happening at Konami before everyone knew what was happening at Konami.
Yep.
And then 2 days later it gets taken down by Konami, so everyone's like, okay, it was legit. Well, so that
Hang on, pause. I don't want to get too deep into this, but it got taken out by Konami because he didn't have enough corroborating sources, because that's how journalism works. But continue.
Well,
No. That is the reason. It doesn't matter whether or not it's true.
Either way, got taken down by Konami, which is shady as fuck.
No, so it's correct. They were following the law. Don't be slandering them, because they will sue the shit out of us. And also, I want to be fair to
them.
They
don't give a fuck.
As much as as much as I hate them, like, to be fair, they did what anyone else would have done if someone with one source produced a story like that and were like, hey, this is the truth.
Yeah, but it is Super Bunny Hop, and he's not the biggest source of information.
No, I'm aware. We just want to be above board with why. Right. I don't disagree with you, I'm just saying, like, it's important to understand that what they did wasn't incorrect.
So, like, I guess, like, I did want to give it to both of them. I gave it to one, because I'll give it to Super Bunny Hop later.
Oh, okay. Next year.
Yeah, probably. But, I guess...
Jimquisition on top.
Yeah, Jimquisition is definitely sort of interesting, because he really doesn't give a fuck. You know,
like, well, isn't that indicative of him giving a lot of fucks? Isn't that
well? There isn't really any other games journalist who starts every video standing in front of a podium, well, behind a podium, wearing a mask with a giant purple dildo baseball bat.
That's true.
Basically praising himself for the malevolent god that he apparently is.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, he basically runs a cult,
more or less.
Jim Sterling.
Yeah.
And you know,
I mean, you would.
Yeah, I mean, he's glorious.
Like, it's... Well, he's all right.
You know, thank God for Jim Sterling.
Mm-hmm.
So,
right. Corporate corruption's been around for a while. Games journalism is a cunt.
Yeah.
Basically, everyone in games journal... Okay, if you wake up tomorrow to go to your games journalism job, and, like, just look at yourself in the mirror for, like, 30 seconds, and just go,
and then realize,
this is who I am, and take off your sports jacket that you're wearing over your t-shirt. You don't need it, you're a games journalist. Just every morning. Actually, it doesn't matter what profession you do.
I wonder why you're not doing video game, like, video.
What profession content. You do for a living, like, doesn't matter what it is, when you wake up in the morning, just take, like, a hot 15 seconds, not every morning, look in the mirror and go, this is who I am, and just consider, and then leave. But just for a hot 15 seconds, just be like, what I am wearing is who I am, and then leave the house.
That's brutal, man.
You have to do it. You have to do it, because, like,
I mean, I do that to make sure my hair is in check.
Especially if you're in games journalism.
It's never in check.
It's your hair is wild. It's a wild mane.
Yeah.
But yeah, just hot 30, just like, this is who I am. Come to terms with it.
So that's my favorite content of the year.
Come to terms with it, we'll change. Yeah,
Jim
good.
Sterling.
Mine was Oh No, a Ghost.
What?
Okay, so Oh No, a Ghost is a miniseries done by the Sans Pants guys, and it's maybe the dumbest, cleverest show that's ever been made. It's Jackson Bailey, or Jackson B. Bailey from one of their podcasts. He sits at a desk, and each week, it started on Halloween, so it's not, they've only done like six episodes, but it's by far my favorite thing that anyone's ever produced. And it started with him, like, debunking ghosts, but the entire episode he didn't talk about ghosts once. And then he did an episode on Bigfoot where he didn't talk about Bigfoot, and it's all just right. The best structured. Like, it's a comedically well structured, fantastically produced. It's just it's on point.
Yeah.
And I love it. And he tried to do an episode on Blimp Ladies.
What?
Yeah. And then like in the middle of the
show.
What
is a Blimp Lady?
Exactly. I still don't know. The producer was like, "No, you can't. That's dumb. Do it on something else." And he was like, "Nah, but I've got these notes." And he like holds up the script. He's like, "But I wrote the script." She's like, "No, do something else." Like in the middle of the video, he's like, "Nah, okay." Oh, man. And at the end, it cuts, and the producer's like, "That wasn't scripted. I just thought it was a dumb night." He didn't tell me what he was doing before, and that was stupid. Such a good show, like just on point. So yeah, go check that out. Sans Pants Radio. Sans is an S-A-N-S.
Like without pants.
Yeah, without pants. It's so good. It's just great. I don't need to say anything more about that. What was your music album of the year?
El Huevo, World's End.
I thought you were going to pick something from Daft Punk, because you normally do.
Nah, they're a bit wild. They're a bit old.
Like if it does not normally stop you.
If this was last year, I would do.
That's true.
Random Access Memories. You would. But it's not last
and
year.
And I wouldn't hear the end of it.
No.
So say that again.
El Huevo, World's End.
I don't know what that is. What's that, Ben?
El Huevo is one of the guys that worked. El Huevo. He's one of the guys that worked on the Hotline Miami soundtrack. But instead of being one of the artists who did a lot of like the really fast and active and like energetic songs,
he did
all the quiet songs.
Ooh, this shit's haunting.
So, he's in Hotline Miami too. He's actually, you know, the beard in Hotline Miami.
Yes,
like that's him.
Oh,
like he's the beard is modeled after him.
That's cool.
So he's basically a stoner. And he makes a lot of.
So you mean he's a musician?
Yeah. So he makes like all his music's really
shout
like
musicians,
like atmospheric and like ambient and really calming. And that World's End. It's not that World's End. What is that, the movie?
That's Pirates of the Caribbean.
Yeah. So World's End...
That's a good soundtrack. Hans Zimmer, get amongst it.
Yeah, it's all right. So World's End is just like a album of ambient tracks, which are all like amazing and beautiful.
Yeah.
And if you like that kind of thing, I guess, get on
it. Yeah, good. Love it.
I don't think any of the songs were from Hotline Miami 2. I think that was...
Totally similar.
That was one album too late.
Okay.
So this is the album after the Hotline Miami 2 album. Yeah. He actually has a game, which I really want to play, called Else Heartbreak. Like, Else Heart dot Break. Open bracket, close bracket. It's a code thing, and it looks really interesting because it actually has an entire coding system inside of it you can actually go to an arcade system and program your games inside of it.
That's groovy.
And like the game itself is like this sort of like exploration
like
RPG heavy dialogue.
Oh, okay.
I mean dialogue heavy RPG.
An RPG heavy dialogue.
I said RPG heavy dialogue.
I guess that's a thing.
RPG heavy dialogue thing.
It's a machine
with this random entire mini game system underneath it.
That's pretty cool.
But I haven't played it, so of course it's not.
I don't know how, but you made music albums about games. Damn.
Yeah,
man.
I know.
Clever.
Surprising.
My music album of the year.
Don't worry,
was...
like the rest of my things are about games anyway.
Good. I was worried they weren't gonna be. My music album of the year was Steam Powered Giraffe's Vice Quadrant.
Fuck, I need to listen to that.
It's their space opera album.
That's out.
Oh, it's maybe the greatest.
I forgot that because it's not on Spotify.
I've listened to it.
Get it.
Yeah, God, because they want to make money. Sorry.
God damn it.
No, look, I pay for Spotify, but it's a fucking gimp if you're an artist. Yeah. Don't put your stuff on Spotify. Seriously, if you're an artist and you need to make money, do not put it on Spotify.
Yeah, because you won't make any.
Yeah, put it on Bandcamp and just keep it cheap. That's what I bought their stuff off Bandcamp.
Yeah, most of the music I buy, it's off Bandcamp.
Yeah, and I just add it to my
iTunes. If it says, like, oh, minimum $3, I'll give you $5.
Mm.
If it's, like, pay what you want,
it depends on the album.
I'll give you $5. Yeah,
it depends on what it is.
It's like 4 songs. I'm gonna give you a buck.
This is a 2.5 hour, two part album. It cost me $16.
I'll give that $5.
It was so good.
Unless it's minimum $16.
I think the minimum is $16, but it's
like
when
they do that.
It's 2.5 hours. Do you know how much music that is?
Yeah, but
that's basically 100 hours.
I suppose they do
a
lot.
That's like $100. That's like 100 songs worth of stuff.
They do a lot of acoustic stuff.
Yeah, it's also mostly
like
not.
I'm used to like 2.5 hours of like ambience being like $2 because
it's
the same.
It's 2.5 hours of exhausting story. Like, it's so good. It's probably my favorite thing they've done, and it's like,
I mean,
it's
whole
super experimental.
So just look up Steam Powered Giraffe right now if you're at home.
Yeah,
they're,
pause. Go look it up.
Yeah, they're incredible. I mean, the first time I saw them, I thought it was CGI.
Yes.
I was like, that doesn't
but
look
they're
real.
Just dudes in paint.
Yeah.
Like, it...
Well, even their movements. I think the first time I saw it,
paint.
I was just like, oh, yeah, that's sped up.
Yeah.
Like, they're just doing it half speed, speeding it up.
Nope.
No, they move like that.
It's so good.
It's weird.
So yeah, the new album though is great because it's basically about the robots, and they go to space for this particular mission, and it's all about it's about like, it's not directly about them, but it's about the events that are happening when they're moving through space. So there's like different heroes and stuff in space.
When they like technically, like canonically, they're built in like the 1800s.
Yeah. So like,
at least the Spiners, which so means the other two would be older.
So there's a comic book that, no, the Spine was built in the 22nd century and got time travel back. There's a comic book, I think, okay, maybe. There's a comic book that goes with them that you have to read if... You don't have to read it to understand it, but I just think you should read it.
It's Rabbits.
Yeah, well, there's like 300 or 400 issues. Like, it's been going for ages.
Oh, wow. Yeah, like, I started
it's a webcomic in inverted commas, but it there's comics for each of their albums that match up, and there's interim comics. Yeah. But yeah, so the premise of the new one is that the robots meet a satellite. So the Earth exists in the Vice Quadrant, which is this spatial area, and it's all about the events that occur in this Vice Quadrant, and so it's about, like, heroes being born and dying, and villains getting born and dying, stuff like this, and they do some really cool shit, like, really cool.
Yeah, I mean, the...
It's just, like, if you think about the fact that it's just music, the amount of world-building they do,
it's
also just still a song by itself, if you don't know anything else, like, it's just so good.
Yeah, they're really good at building just...
Oh, it's so good.
Like, the universe. Yeah. Like, they have three albums, right? There's four. Oh, okay.
So they've got the
like self-titled.
The first one's the Steam Man Band or something.
And then there's Two Cent Show, and then MK
Mark III, and then and then the Vice Quadrant.
Yeah, because Two Cent was like probably their breakout album.
Yeah, and that was when John left.
Yeah, and it got good.
Yeah, and then Hatchworth joined them.
The John was really bad.
He was just different. I think Hatchworth is so good.
Hatchworth is so much more interesting.
Hatchworth in the new one is great. He becomes this like creepy, insane person.
There's a new one?
That is in the new album.
Oh, right.
Yeah. But also Steve, their sound engineer, becomes a character as well.
Yeah, he became one sort of in MK3.
Yeah, so he's sort of the guy that runs, and then they've got Gigi, their giraffe, and then a few other characters and stuff that they keep in. And there's just some really cool stuff they do. There's a few kind of like weird choices with like Gigi has a song that's just kind of annoying, but like by and large it's such a sense of, it's an album that I listened to the first time and I was like eh, and I've listened to it probably like I dread probably like 40 or 50 times now.
Oh yeah, I had the same with MK3.
Like I just keep like I'll wake up every morning and I'll be like, what am I gonna listen to on the train this album?
Yeah, like with MK3, like I listen to it and I'm like, it's not the Two Cent Show. No. Like, it doesn't have the amazing songs.
But it just grows on you so slowly.
But you just keep watching it, and you're like, oh my god.
I have so many favorite
songs. The song about the shoes.
I have so many favorite songs now. Like,
oh my god, yeah.
It's, yeah, but yeah, that's my favorite. Like, it's so good. Honorable mention goes to Logic's latest album, just because it's... I mentioned that before, but it's just really... It's really well-produced. Tucker did a bunch of... like versions for Triple J that were really good that are worth checking out. They're not really albums, just that I mentioned those. I mentioned Triple J a lot today.
Yeah, twice.
Yeah. That's a lot. Yeah, that's a lot compared to normal.
Yeah.
Okay, print media. What did you have for print media of the year?
I had an ebook called Team Ben, A Year as a Professional Gamer.
Team Ben?
Which is...
It's not about you, is it?
No, it's not about
okay,
me.
Good. I was like...
I've told you about this before. You probably don't remember. It's about Melee.
Mm.
I'm putting games and everything. If you watch the Smash Brothers documentary,
yes,
and you want a more like personal, like retelling
of
the story,
yeah,
then Team Ben, A Year of the Professional Gamer, is the saddest thing ever.
Oh,
it's basically the same story. It's like 2005 to 2006 of Melee, which was like one of the biggest sort of periods for the game.
Yeah,
and it's a basically the story of one of the players called Wife and his team called Team Ben. And you're like, all right, Team Ben. Cool. I don't want to spoil it because it's like, it's amazing. It's pretty short. It's like I read it in like 2 hours.
Yeah.
And I'm a slow reader. Yes. So I mean, it's short.
Yeah. But so what Ben's saying is like probably like 45 minutes.
Yeah.
Like if it's me, it'd be
less pretty quick.
Yeah,
it's pretty short.
Pretty short. Yeah.
But you definitely, like, I would recommend having knowledge of like the history of Smash before going in, because it'll make a lot more sense.
Yeah,
because it's from the perspective of Wife, who is one of probably like the smartest and most influential commentators for Smash.
Yeah,
like it wasn't very good. Like Team Ben was known for doubles play. It was husband and wife, which were these two players that were really good.
Yep,
like in doubles. Like in singles, they didn't do very well, but it meant that this guy Wife, whose real name's Chris, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
He was able to sort of view like the top players without being a top player, because he could see what was happening with all the top single players.
Okay.
As a top doubles player, not having to like worry about, oh, I actually have to beat these players. You could just see it.
Yeah,
like,
just absorbing. Yeah.
So he has probably one of the best perspectives on just who everyone is like.
Yeah.
Like he talks a bit in the documentary about how like people who play Smash have like their Smash personality, like how they play in Smash and what they're like whether they're arrogant, whether they're aggressive, defensive, whatever.
Yeah.
But then when they stop playing Smash, when they put the controller down, like what are they like then?
Yeah.
And normally you don't get to see that, but he was able to really see it when the game was like developing.
You get to know the kind of people that are that are involved in that community.
So he has a really good perspective, and it's a really good read if you like Smash.
I think that kind
of
thing,
especially if you kind of like the personalities.
Yeah.
It
I think that's an interesting perspective.
It puts it in a really good light.
I think it's always good to have that context as well.
Yeah.
Because it's easy to... Because I think the thing that... I mean, I've talked about this a little bit before, but like... People sometimes will complain. They're like, oh, like... And this has only happened to me a few times where I've met someone who I've worked with through the channel or through other projects I've worked on. And I'll meet them outside of a work context. So like, I'll just happen to bump into them or something.
Yeah.
And they're like, oh, you're super different in person than you're working. It's exactly, and you're like, well, that's because... Like. That working personality is just like a different version of me than when I'm walking on the street. Mm. And they're like, oh, you're really standoffish on the street. I'm like, it's because I was listening to my iPod, like zoned out because I was thinking about what I'm buying for groceries or whatever. Like, I'm not like, it's just, you're different people when you're in different places.
Yeah.
And I think something that I've talked about a bit before, and I recommend going to see Will Anderson is doing Fire at Will. It's his new show. Depending on when this comes out, he might have finished it or whatever. But it's about public spaces versus private spaces, and the understanding that, like, in your private space, you can do whatever you want. I don't care. Like, you can have as many weird orgies as you want. You can smoke whatever you want. You can do as many drugs as you want. I don't care. You can yell as much as you want. You can have your eight white male friends over and get drunk, whatever. When you're in a public space, you have to be aware that, like, your actions have impacts on other people using that space. So if you have 8 white male friends, don't walk around in a pack making loud noises, because you make everyone uncomfortable and you make women feel like they're going to be attacked.
Yeah.
Like, just be aware that, like, you have a presence in a... And you, like, you have to be aware that there's a social contract that goes with being in a public space, and just realize that your actions have consequences.
Yeah.
So that's, I think, always an interesting perspective to have when you look at something like a tournament like Smash or something, because the people that are in that tournament are just people. Like, they're just dudes who have jobs.
Pretty much, yeah. Most, like, of them don't even play Smash for their job.
They're just guys that have jobs that do this for fun. And people are like, oh, you did such and such, go kill yourself. And that's just a dude with, like, a wife and maybe a kid, or, like, a dude with, like, a lovely boyfriend, and you're just being a cunt for no reason. Like, just be aware that, like, public... Like, you should... like, as a person, I'm saying, you should understand that there is a difference between public and private space. And I always think stuff like that is a really good way to show people that.
Yeah,
and have them realize that.
So if you want to read it, it's on.
Yeah, how do people get to it?
You can probably just Google Team Ben ebook, and it comes up. It's free, and it's hosted on a website called Smash Reads, which is pretty funny because it has nothing to do with Smash.
No,
but just Chris was just like, he was just like, yeah, this place seems like a good place to upload this.
It's got the right name.
Book about Smashes.
Yeah, it's got the right name.
Yeah, so
good.
So it's on. Yeah,
Smash get onto e-books. That. I might even link that in the comments, in the show notes.
It's definitely, like, not a lot of people know about it, because he didn't really advertise it. He just sort of, like, wrote it.
Well, I guess it's not the kind of thing you would want to...
Held it for ages.
Not the kind of thing you would want to advertise.
Yeah, and then put it up.
Yeah.
Because, like, the first few sections of it, which sort of explains who he is and who... Basically what Team Ben is.
Yep.
It's real sad. It's pretty bad.
Okay. Yeah, so get him...
And it puts him in, like... You read that and you realize, oh, that's why wife is how he is.
Okay.
You sort of realize, oh, that's why he has this perspective.
Yeah. Okay. So yeah, get into that. That sounds like I'm probably going to read that actually in the afternoon when I have some time. But yeah, podcast of the year. What'd you have?
The TOVG podcast.
Good choice. You should explain for the people at home.
So that is Super Bunny Hop, George Weidman's podcast with his friends. It's just a video game podcast.
Pretty much.
But, when you said, like, you know, internet show and podcast, I was like, one of them is going to be, like, Jim Sterling's, and one of them is going to be George Weidman's. Because I love
those guys.
The
question is, which way?
And they both have podcasts, and they both have, like, internet shows.
Yeah.
So, I mean, Jim Sterling's podcast is pretty much the same as his show. It's just a lot less formal.
Yeah.
But it's got the same amount of butt jokes and dick jokes and
yeah,
just crass humor.
It's
whereas with Super Bunny Hop is that the podcast is a lot more, it's like the same, it's a lot less formal, but that's actually different to his show.
Yes.
Because his show is very well, like, it's very structured, very, like, well edited.
Yeah.
Like, written, he's, like, he actually has a journalism degree, so he, like, he actually puts a lot of effort.
It reminds me more of, like, a Philip DeFranco.
Yeah.
Kind of thing.
And he, so, but his podcast, where it's just him and his friends, you know, you're able to actually get a sort of...
You get a sense of what he's like.
Yeah.
Like, and you get a sense of his opinions, I think.
And I really like it. Plus, he just has opinions that I like, because he sort of, he doesn't really get caught on the hype. He just sort of takes things as it comes.
I think we've talked about this a lot, but, like, I think that's why I really associate with Funhouse, the crew of Rooster Teeth.
Yeah.
So Adam Kovic's crew. Is because, like, every time that someone is excited for something, Lawrence is like, nah, shut the fuck up. Like,
those guys are funny, because I remember, like, years ago when I used to sort of actually follow Machinima when they were with
Machinima. Inside gaming at Machinima, yeah.
Yeah, they would sort of get into the hype, you know.
Well, yeah, because they
like
that was
Skyrim really, with guns.
They were
like,
kind of
shit
like
that.
They were kind of like games journalists at that point, and they've transitioned to this weird interim space
where
between,
they just hate video games.
Well, kind of. they're like, they occupy this weird space where they're almost games journalists, but they're still just Let's Players.
Yeah.
And so they have some really interesting.
Well, they're ex-journalists.
Yeah.
Who
so
are
they,
now Let's Players.
So they sometimes will get scoops and stuff, but they'll report on it like it's a conversation, not like they're trying to be like the first person to have discovered it. So it's just. Yeah, they have a great podcast called Dude Soup, which isn't my, it's not my podcast of the year, it's honorable mention, because it's great. And I think that it comes from a similar place.
Yeah.
Yeah, I really enjoy that balanced perspective.
Yeah. So that's what I'm going to, TOVG podcast. It's hard as dicks to find, because you type in TOVG podcast, and the first one you get is that one video gamer podcast, which isn't the one I'm talking about, because that's The Completionist.
Yes.
Which is, he's that one video gamer. Like, that's his channel. It's like the second one on the list. If you go TOVG podcast and Google, it's the second one on the list. I think if you go through superbunnyhop.com, you can find
Or if you just go to their YouTube channel.
Yeah,
it's
on their
YouTube linked
channel.
In all of their notes and stuff. Mine was, podcast of the year for me was D&D is for Nerds.
Yeah, I saw that one coming.
So D&D for Nerds. Yeah, D&D for Nerds is, again, by the Santa Pants crew. I'm just a big fan of the stuff they produce. And it's just, it's them doing a super lowbrow D&D campaign, and it's super dumb, and it's just fun.
Yeah.
And they don't overproduce it, they don't underproduce it. It's just well made, it's well structured. It's great.
Wow, haven't heard of that idea before.
No. It's not like we do that
That's super
as well.
Original.
Yeah. but yeah, no, they just do it well, and it doesn't try to be anything that it's not. But I'm going to look at my phone really quick and look at the other podcasts just for my little mentions, because I listen to so many. Because I work at a... For those of you who don't know, I work a desk job, so I listen to podcasts all day.
Yeah.
So obviously, anything from Sans Pants, so obviously I've mentioned them a bunch. The Weekly Planet, which is the official podcast at comicbookmovies.com. Which is Mr. Sunday Movies and Nick Mason, and they just go through, like, each week they'll do, like, a big roundup of, like, the comic book movie news or just comic book news in general, and then they'll talk about something. So, like, this week they talked about the Batman v Superman trailer, they did Jessica Jones a few weeks ago, and then they talked about how bad Spectre is a week before that or whatever. Like,
but
just
Spectre
that kind of
was fine!
I mentioned a bunch of this stuff before, but Tofop, Fofop, and Willosophy, so all of Will Anderson stuff. But other than that, yeah, I just listen to, like, a bunch of stuff because I just have nothing to do all day with my ears.
Yeah.
I do boring daughter intro.
I'm more of a video podcast because I do a lot of coding. So it's just
it's something to
one
watch.
Screen code, other screen moving image with sound.
Oh, I just have Netflix going when I'm doing writing or something. True. So I just have it, like, usually music, and then, like, I usually, honestly, normally I do music and then a let's play of a game that I've not played with the sound off. And it sounds dumb. But it's like,
from a
writing perspective, it's really good to see shit out of context, because it's like, oh, that's a weird landscape I've never seen. So I'll normally do like Bloodborne or Dark Souls.
Oh, that'd be good, yeah.
Which is really handy. So that's a weird tip if you're sitting at home and you're like, I have trouble concentrating when I'm writing. Put on some like music that gets you focused, and then put on some visuals that are like constantly changing.
I usually watch like TV shows when I'm coding, but I was like, yeah, I'll code and watch, One Punch Man at the same time. Except it's got subtitles. So I can't. I have to pay attention to it.
Get your dub shit. I haven't done it yet.
No, there's no dice.
All right, so honorable mentions of stuff that we love this year that didn't come up at all. Anything comes to your head immediately?
Shit, I remembered something like halfway through this, but I forgot it.
Yeah, that's the way. Yeah. Okay, honorable
I've generally
mentions.
Mentioned most of them.
Yeah, I've kind of touched on most of them. I mean, we did a whole podcast on Fallout 4, but that's... Actually, I want to talk about that in, like... I'm not going to talk about it too much, because we always talk about Fallout, but,
You always talk about it, Fallout.
I can't help it. It's because it's all I've been doing. I recorded, like, 18 episodes over the weekend.
Yeah.
Like, I just... It's... I've done a bunch more of the story now, finally. I mean, I'm, like, 60 hours in, and I've finally done the first story mission.
Congrats.
Yeah, it is really good, and the characters in it are really good.
I'm still waiting for it to be $40.
It's never going to happen.
I'll get it for $40.
It's really good,
just
and it's really interesting, and, like... It just, yeah, and they have, I don't want to spoil anything, but there's a particular detective you meet who is my favorite character.
He looks pretty cool.
He's
I'm looking forward to playing Fallout 4 eventually.
They do this
just
great,
for the companions.
They do this great thing where they're like, here's a trope, and then they just spin it. And they're like, they just a little, they just give it a little bit of a tweak, and it's like, oh, that's way more interesting than it ever could have been in any other context.
Because he's a robot.
Well, no, that's a spoiler, though. I'm going to have to bleep that. It is actually a spoiler.
Because there's a boop!
Yeah, there'll be a beep there. But yeah, I mean, like, a good example is, like, Piper, one of the characters you meet, who's in some of the pre-release content. They do an interesting thing with her where you expect her to act one way and then she does the opposite.
Yeah, she was like, you could get her on Fallout Vault.
Yeah.
Like, weeks
and
before
so they do
the
this kind of,
came out.
Yeah, so there's an interesting thing.
She was pretty heavily pushed as, look, she's important.
She's awesome. Yeah. She ended up being... She inadvertently, I was just too nice to her, and she ended up being my love interest, and then I was like, well, I guess we've done that now.
Well, actually, one funny thing that Jim Sterling did on Fallout 4 was he commented on the fact that you can just fuck anyone,
yep,
as many people as you want, and no one cares. He's like, that's nice. It's like, it's basically polyamory.
Well, it also
it's
makes
like
sense.
It's a AAA game addressing polyamory very mature way.
I've talked about this before, but like, it also makes sense, because if you're in the wasteland, there's no one else around to see you fucking someone else.
It's also just a case of like you can literally sleep with someone, wake up, go outside to another companion you've been sleeping with, they just don't care.
No, they
it's don't like, care. Cool.
It's the wasteland.
Good game.
Everyone's dead. Also, my favorite comic I've ever seen is
the SJWs are attacking Fallout 4. Oh no!
No, 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 no.
Polyamory.
They probably will.
It's not.
They probably might.
It's literally an oversight.
They probably love it.
Which just ended up being, oh my god, polyamory in Fallout 4.
You can also fuck anyone. It doesn't matter your race or gender.
Yeah,
that's
also
whatever.
That's kind of like
that's Bethesda in a nutshell.
Yeah.
But like, one of the things that's great. I saw this great webcomic. I cannot reference where it was from because it was on my Tumblr. I don't know, but it's. It's like the vault. It's like your character, your playable character, in the vault suit. That's how you know it's them. And someone's like, "Hey, have you found your son yet?" And like it, they're like, "Hey, have you found your son yet?" And he goes, "Huh? What son?" And then it just cuts back, and he turns back around, and he's making out with Piper on the couch. Like, that's basically the game. You just forget about your son. But yeah, shit, I talked about Fallout 4. I didn't mean to. Other honorable mentions. I've been watching the latest season of Pokemon for research. I hate it. Hate it. I was so on board.
What region is it?
X and Y. So
wow, they're really far behind. Kalos.
No, not X. Yeah, X and Y, the most recent games.
That's you mean Oris, most recent games?
Huh?
XY isn't most recent.
What's the most recent?
The remake for Oris.
Huh?
What
words are you saying?
The remake for Ruby Sapphire, Omega Ruby.
Yeah.
Alpha Sapphire.
Don't abbreviate it, you dickhead.
Oris. O-R-A-S.
I don't know what that is.
How do you not know what Pokemon Oris is?
Why would that ever come up?
Because that's the most recent one.
Yeah, but those are remakes. They're not going to make the anime of that. That'd be fucking weird if Ash
is going
back to do my old story.
No, because Oris is an alternate timeline.
I understand that.
Ruby Sapphire.
But you can't alternate Ash. I guess you could. They have.
They could. They have.
Also, Ash is way cooler now. But he's also a character. He's not just a dickhead.
Wow,
anyway,
that's a fuss.
But yeah, no, I hate it. But for like a myriad of reasons. But I was gonna give an honorable mention only because I've watched so much of it because I have to for research. Like, yeah,
that's
it's
depressing.
It's pretty sad. Other games. I mean, I kind of talk about everything I tend to play on the show, so I don't think there's anything.
I guess honorable mention to Dirty Bomb. It took away 100 hours of my life, and
I've mentioned
and
that.
Before, fuck them up.
Yeah. No, I don't think there's anything else. I think that'll probably do us. It's about an hour on the nose there.
Yeah.
Where can people find us, Ben?
On the internet.
On the internet, good. One day you'll get the plugs, probably not. So DCM.works, in the show notes, we've got our Patreon, and you should buy a t-shirt also, we have t-shirts now.
I have to buy a t-shirt, because David will get one for me.
Yeah. What? You didn't ask for one.
David, can I have a t-shirt?
No. might buy Ben a t-shirt. But yeah, so grab a t-shirt. They're a good time. If you like our D&D podcast, we've also got some ones coming up for AFA. Get the one for Ben's Ben's company.
Oh god, yeah, there's one for me.
Yeah, the finger gun.
Yeah.
Get that one, the pan one as well. And there's also one with your face on it.
Yeah, that one's
good.
Yeah,
that's right.
That's weird.
I'm getting that on a mug. Let's go take it to work. I
actually get that with the mug as well.
It's gonna be good. That's more of a mug than a shirt design.
I get people wanting a shirt.
You can buy it on a shirt. Put it on a pillow and sleep with us. Sleep with us next to your face.
Sleep with my face.
Sleep with your face next to your face. You can get my my face from my YouTube channel if you want. But otherwise, yeah, I think that's about all the plugs. On Twitter, we're DCM_works.
Yeah.
Everywhere else with DCM.works or Digital and Creative Media Works. And yeah, I think that's about it. Any closing thoughts?
Nah.
This year was not a great year for films. Next year's gonna be insane.
No.
Next year's gonna be mental.
This year's going to end well on films, because Star Wars Episode 7 is coming out. It's gonna be the best movie ever.
Nah, it's gonna be a film. Next year we got Batman v Superman, and then we got Captain America Civil War, and more importantly, Guardians of the Galaxy 2, which I'm so excited for.
Yeah, that'll be good.
Oh my god, Guardians of the Galaxy
was like, I literally stopped caring about Marvel.
Yeah, I dissed that film, The Guardians.
But I like Guardians of the Galaxy. It's really good.
Yeah, I'm not even excited. I want Batman v Superman, because it's different. I'm just sick of Marvel.
I'm kind of excited for Star Wars.
Yeah. Oh, look. It'll at least be a film, and that's all it needs to do.
Yeah,
I'm not gonna lie, I'm the most excited I've been for anything ever, but like, I'm very cautious.
Yeah,
that's a bit weird. But yeah, so that's gonna do it for this one, guys. I've done all my plugs. So I've been David.
I'm Ben.
And yeah, we'll see you guys next time.
Bye.
Bye.
Soundtrack's amazing. Yeah, the visuals are very well done, and like the gameplay is super fun, and like because those three things are there, it's like it's exceptionally good.
I could do it in a heartbeat and make millions, but it would feel like gouging my soul out.
Yeah, Jurassic Park's a little more like DDR.
If Shrek is a fairy tale creature, can he actually own land and want to kick them off?
Where did that come from?
You have to make a lot of shit up to make good art.
Yeah.
That's just the truth, buddy.